Good morning, everybody. I'm Dong Joo from Korea University Hospital, and in this session, the co-chair doctor is Dr. Hong Myeong-Ki from Severance Hospital, and Dr. Geishi Igarashi Hanaoka from Japan. We are going to proceed to the second live case, the demonstrating cases. Okay. Dr. Bao, so are you available now?
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yeah, good.
Okay. We prepared some of one of the very interesting cases. Our team is Dr. Kang, and our interpreter is Professor Jung-Sun Kim, and the technician No is participate our meeting. Is Dr. Kang, can you introduce patient history?
Yeah, good morning. I will introduce our case. The patient is a 66-year-old female, and several months ago, he started the airport-related chest pain. And although she has a history of only dyslipidemia, but when she visited other hospital, the diffuse cerebral vessel was checked. So she wanna treat at our hospital, so she visited our hospital, and today we're gonna treat her coronary artery disease.
Okay, this patient is a 66, relatively young female, and admitted with a stable angina, and we checked the coronary angio is definitely the multivessel disease. Look at the first view and the right coronary region, and look at this view, and there was some diffuse region from the prox LAD to the mid LAD, and also can you show us the left coronary angio? Look at this is the epicaudal view, and you can find the diffuse region of the sulc region and some involvement of the obtuse marginal branch. And the next, and this is the epicranial view, and you can easily find some discrete tandem region of the distal LAD or the prox LAD. So if you're gonna think about try to put the drug eluting stent, I think we need two drug eluting stent, the prox mid RCA, and the two drug eluting stent, the sulc region, and the two drug eluting stent, mid prox LAD, and at least the six drug eluting stent is required for 66 relatively young the woman's patient. So, and today I would like to introduce some the hybrid strategies. The BVS and with combination of the drug eluting stent, relatively simple region, try to BVS and some relatively complex region like a bifurcation region and the ostium region, we try to put the drug eluting stent. So we first treat the right coronary region, and so the BVS hybrid strategy, any comment from panel and any another suggestion for how do we effectively treat, how do we safely treat this multivessel disease patients? It just except bypass surgery.
what is your criteria to use to differentiate to use the BRS or the DES?
Yes.
What is your criteria?
Yeah, right. It's we have now the lot of data just. The most of data is evidence from the expert opinion, and we need more large of data. It's just available review article is Euro intervention, it's a Colombo group, and a couple of weeks later is another hybrid strategy review article will be published in the JAG intervention. It's a complex, what is not eligible for the BVS, and relatively simple, eligible for BVS. Complex, I think left main lesion and osteal lesion and the calcified lesion would be not eligible for the BVS. But BVS region, some large the caliber, even though long lesion, if you ensure the optimal the dilation is eligible for the BVS, just the left main and the bifurcation requiring two stent strategy is osteal region is not eligible for BVS. Another remaining region would be we can treat the BVS to skip to save the number of metal stent.
So therefore, the what region is the acceptable for the in this patient for the PRS implantation?
Yes, I think the this patient is the right region is proximal, is eligible for BVS. The osteo, the left circumflex region is a bifurcation. The, if the urgent case we require the two stand, the bifurcation region is eligible for the drug-eluting stent, metal stent, LAD region, is the distal part is eligible for BVS, but proximal part is involving the ostium is try to put the metal stent.
So therefore, you try to the BRS in the right coronary
region?
Yeah,
right.
Okay. When you deploy the BRS implantation, you just do the angiographic guidance or the imaging guidance?
Yes, I'm definitely the IBUS oriented interventional cardiologist, and we do the in our cath lab is with some of we are the plan to the clinical trial comparing the angio guided versus IBUS guided the BVS implantation. So for me is the overall depending on the IBUS measurement is we so check the pre-intervention IBUS. Can you, Dr. Kim, can you introduce the IBUS?
Dr. Park?
Yes.
This is Inocho speaking.
Yeah.
And then I'd like to mention about the strategy for using
we
the hybrid.
We did not see the IBUS images.
Okay.
Yeah. Let me start from the IBUS image from the pullback to the from the distal RCA. So this is, as you can see, this part is a distal RCA reference diameter around 3.5, and proximal part is around 4.0. So when we pull back the IBUS from the distal to the proximal, as you can see, this is a distal part, and most of the plaque is there is some attenuated plaque here, but there is no significant or severe calcification over all the region. So this is all pullback the IBUS, and region length is around 42 millimeters. 42. So when we plan to implant a BRS, we need a two stent.
Okay, so the we definitely follow the PSP, the technique, and everybody knows the raised concern in the TST meeting is observed to the 3-year result. There is a very late stent thrombosis case, more case in the BBS. Is the most of observer 3, observer 2 is the PSP technique applied less than 10%. Is the after the adaption of the PSP technique goes to your trial and the large the available studies, a couple of the weeks ago published in JAG article is a German and Swedish study. After insertion, adaption of the PSP technique, they reduced more than 50% of the ischemic the risk of stent thrombosis and the MI and something like that. So we definitely follow the PSP technique, and then next, we did the pre-dilation, it's matched the reference vessel diameter. The
what size of the balloon?
3.0. It's a non-compliant balloon. And next, this is 3.5.
3.4.
Yeah, 3.5. So the problem is that the main intervention is the field. If you do PSP technique, after P, is that there is some higher chance of the dissection. And the next, so we put the cover the distal part of the dissection. This is 3.5 at the BVS at the 28.
What pressure?
It's just 6 atm is nominal pressure. It's slowly inflated up to 20 seconds. Manufacturer recommendation is 25, but RCA region is 20 seconds, 15 seconds would be okay. And the next. And the proximal part, we put the additional, the BVS is 23, 23,
3.5, and some pressure was the previous images, the overlapping is a very important message to the audience.
Yes.
So before that, they deploy the first the BRS, and just before the second BRS, then pressure was it's too fast.
Yeah, right. So
before that, before the dead image.
That is very important portion. Is look at the there is some three or four millimeter
marker in the distal BRS.
Yeah, right,
and the balloon marker was over.
Yeah, right.
It means that the How do you expect the, what is the length of the scaffold overlap?
Yeah, right. That is very good position. Is that this image shows some too much overlapping. But this, I think about at this time is the proximal landing zone. It's the proximal landing zone. Is the if you more proximally the pull back, the you we should expand more than 4.2, 4.3. Is expect some the under expansion. Is that portion proximal part is 4.0 diameter. If you more the proximally pull back, we should dilate this 4.5. So I some the worry about the too much expansion. This currently available the manufacturer recommendation.
Okay,
limited
therefore
0.5.
The, when the after the PRS deployment, when we do the IFC imaging, and then we clearly see the what is the length of the overlapped portion.
Yeah,
please
right,
show
right.
Us.
Yeah, right, right.
It's
right.
An important message to the audience.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
So yeah, right. Is the BBSM there are large available some lengths with exactly put the stand length, but is that case is proximal landing zone is not easy. So and then is the proximal landing zone. Can you show us the okay, test. We did high pressure balloon dilation, and next.
What size of it?
This is a distal part is 3.5, and uh-huh. Proximal part is 4.0. And I try to optimize the position of the proximal landing zone. And the QG shows the smart, the stand view, is Siemens. This is the clean stand. Yes, clear stand, and the Philips is a stand booster. It's easy to find the exact positioning of the proximal stand, and after using the clear stand view, and the well matched the proximal position, and the next. This is the final image. We also checked the final IBUS. Dr. Kim, could you briefly introduce the final IBUS image?
Yeah. We pull back from the distal part here.
Could you show us the IBUS images in the full series from the distal end of the PRS?
Yeah.
Not the 3D reconstruction, real image.
This is a pullback from the distal ICA. Yeah, as you can see, there is some distal part of the PRS. There is no dissection, fully dilated. The scaffold is fully dilated. There is no significant under expansion here. So overall, yeah, minimal lumen, scaffold area is over 7.0. So it's quite adequate for this patient. So this
scaffold
there
is
somewhat overlap.
Attached.
Yeah.
Yes.
Attached to the best wall, yeah. Compared to that. No bar position at this point. There is a two scaffold as shown here.
One length. Please measure
Around the 5 millimeter is overlap. Yeah.
Diameter is good too. Almost 3-0.
Yes.
Stand diameter, right?
Yeah.
Area
this is
concern
three.
Is more than 7 millimeter scale, something.
Yeah. Yeah. That's good.
Quite a big, good opposition.
Until now, there is no more opposition. But we have a concern about the proximal part of the RCA because RCA, proximal RCA is around 4.0, 4.1. So this is approaching to the proximal part. There is this part.
Good.
Yeah.
Good opposition.
Yeah, yeah, there is right. A good opposition.
How frequently do you use OCT evaluation for the PBS? The game.
Yeah, me? I usually OCT is around 30% of case. Uh-huh. Yeah, sometimes we perform the BRS implantation using just angiography.
OCT.
Yeah, OCT.
In my practice, I usually 100% OCT for BBS implantation. As you know that as you can see, the IFC image is not clearly the opposition of the BBS implantation status. So I think that the OCT is better for the initial learning curve period of PVC implantation.
Yeah, yeah, definitely, definitely. Yeah. Yeah. Retro resolution is very better
compared with better OCT imaging. Yeah. IVC imaging, not clearly the standard patient status.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. So, this patient is definitely sleep vessel disease.
Since you believe it's more fine, you know, findings. However, still. We need more in terms of a clinical relevant data. It's more microscopic. It's not always, you cannot discriminate is really good or not, right? We got some, and so I still, we need a more kind of, in the later cases, Dr. Lee actually do some cases, IVUS guided, QCA guided, even, you know, imaging guided, QCA guided. If we have some good concept in terms of a good opposition, high-pressure inflation, I don't need it. Personally, I don't need it in almost all cases. It's a OCT guided, visual things is good. So we need, I think we need more data.
Yes, so I mean the, in this situation, we all of the beginners for BBS implantation. So as you mentioned, that we need more data.
All right, great. Yeah. Agree.
So the Asan Medical Center early experience, and we did the PBS case more than 300 cases. We definitely 100% follow PSP technique. Even though the follow-up duration was limited, we did not experience any early stages scaphoid thrombosis. So we moved to the circumflex, and we put the two wire and to protect the obtuse marginal branch and keep the main branch. And we checked IVUS, and the obtuse marginal branch is the vessel diameter was 2.0. The ostium was the large amount of the plaque. Then our bifurcation strategy is a stent crossover, and then if you require, we do the provisional, the high pressure provisional, the Kissing balloon, or just leave it alone. Is so. We checked the true lumen is the IVUS pre-intervention. Can you briefly show us the IVUS is the circ region?
Yeah, this is a pullback from the OM. Yeah, this part. There is the circumflex coming from the around 7 o'clock. There is some austere stenosis, and plaque burden is quite a lot. So I think in this situation, it's possible to jail when we cross from the circumflex proper to the proximal part of circumflex.
Okay.
The other one is 4, 5.
Five.
The other pullback from the circumflex we did. So this is a image pullback from the distal part of circumflex. Yeah, the plaque is existed from the distal pullback the part, and then overall.
This is proximal.
Yeah,
part.
This
the
is
distal,
proximal.
The vessel diameter is 3.0, and the hydrolytic predilation using 2.7, 2.5 non-compliant. The compliant balloon test?
So, vessel diameter at distal part is 3.0, and proximal part is 3.5. So, region length,
10,
overall
10,
region
10,
length.
14.
Yeah. Region length is
around
37 millimeter. So,
10, 12,
we can
14, 16,
cover 16. With this region with 3.8 millimeter stent.
Okay,
yeah.
Test.
So, talk about?
Yes.
Dr. Ba, can you hear me? Okay, what would you do there to further long region?
Yes, Paul, I think this is bifurcation region. I tried to put the long, the metallic stent, is a giant,
okay.
So and then the if needed is a provisional the strategy.
Right.
Okay, go.
Okay, so anyways, we prepare, many cases, and so we're gonna, back and forth, and so we're gonna move another cath lab, and
okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
And then, so we're back to the final result. Okay. Would you check the next cath lab?
Okay. Okay. Good morning, Dr. Ba. Yes, another live demonstration case. Dr. Kang, could you explain the brief history of a patient?
Yes, this patient is a 49-year-old male admitted for chest pain. His coronary CT showed moderate stenosis of medial CA and CAG revealed triple vessel disease. He has a history of hyperlipidemia and a current smoker. Next. And we performed FFR in all three vessels, and LAD FFR showed 0.7, and LCX 0.6, and RCA 0.66. Next. So,
could you show us the left side coronary angiogram? We performed the left side coronary angiogram, showed the circumflex, proximal circumflex tighter stenosis, looks calcified lesion, and next, LAD, prox-LAD tight significant lesion. In addition, look at this, there is some narrowing of distal left main. So, and let's move to the right. So this is a RCA coronary angiogram, diffuse proximal RCA to the middle RCA diffuse long lesion. Initially, my plan is multiple BRS, multi-vessel BRS implantation. I'd like to start with the RCA long BRS overlapping implantation, and then move to the left side. According to the, some kind of IVUS findings, I'd like to decide the BRS implantation or DES hybrid implantation. Okay, I'd like to start with, for this lesion, based on the IVUS finding, IVUS show us, yes, look at this coronary angiogram. Again, coronary angiogram may be roughly 2.5 vessel, but could you show us the IVUS?
Okay.
IVUS is almost 3-0, at least 3-0 vessel. Is it right, Dr. Kang?
Yes, right.
Yes. Please show us the IVUS image.
Okay.
Let's get started this distal reference segment, and you can see the measurement here. So the vessel size is 3.5 millimeter, and lumen size is 3.1 millimeter, and we are approaching to the minimal lumen area site, and there is echolucent plaque, and also you see some small calcification, and the lumen is getting smaller and smaller, and here is the minimal lumen area site, and you can see there was no significant calcification. However, you can see the severe attenuation with the positive remodeling, so that suggests the high risk of periprocedural MI and the presence of vulnerable plaque. And then as we get more proximally, there is a short segment of flake-free lesions. Then, it is getting larger, and you can also see the echolucent plaque with a negative remodeling relative to the distal part. And this lesion showed eccentric lumen with some calcified nodule, and the eccentric plaque with some superficial calcification that suggests the risk of the asymmetry of the stent or the under expansion. Then the calcification is extended to the more proximal part of the lesions, and then the lumen is getting larger and larger. And the minimal lumen area was measured as 2.0 square millimeter, and here is the larger lumen than the distal part, but the calcification is extensive. We can move to the more proximal part. There is a mild plaque with calcification. Then here is here is the significant plaque. Then this is a normally looking segment, and the measurement is here. The vessel size is very big, 4.3 millimeter, but lumen size is 3.5 millimeter. And the ostium of RCA shows the flake-free segment. Okay.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Gang.
So what would you do that, Dr. Gang?
Yes, this patient is very young, very young, only 46 years old, have to live a long life. So I don't like to put the metal stent in this patient. Mm-hmm. So I like to put the bioresorbable observable scaffold for this patient.
What size of the PRS?
Okay. For the Osteal part, you want to multiple PRS,
yes,
right?
Yes, right.
And
right.
So what about the osteal part of a right?
Yes, that is a very important question. The osteal part, some general consensus is to avoid the osteal BRS implantation. But there is some the disease-free zone in the osteal, so I don't like to protrude the implanted scaffold to the aorta, just to exact precisely implanted the scaffold to the less osteal lesion, just distal to the osteal lesion, to avoid the osteal protrusion.
Sure. So what is the plan to the, what size of the PRS for this region?
Yes, that is a very important question again. So. So I already applied to the high pressure using the 3-0 high pressure balloon for lesion modification. As you know, PSP is very important for the BRS implantation. Pre-lesion modification using high pressure contrast. Yes, some dissection.
This is some very interesting cases. The angiographic appearance is a small vessel size. However, the IBIS finding is a vessel size more bigger than the angiographic appearance. Even in the distal mid portion or distal part, the vessel size is a 3.5, more than a 3.5.
Yes, that is
so
very important.
Actually,
yeah.
The PRS size should be the not 3.5.
Yes, that is a very important aspect of I was some kind of imaging guided BRS implantation. But recently, we also do the QCA guided BRS implantation. Could you measure the QCA?
And at the constrictive remodeling site, the vessel size is only 3.0 millimeter.
So, what do you think is in terms of? I want to just you know worry about the osteal part of osteum part,
yes.
Right coronary artery, and you mentioned about the hybrid concern.
Yes, right.
You know, proximal right coronary artery. Just the jugular stand, right?
Yes.
High, you know, one or two segments
yes.
protruding, and
yes.
then the BRS, you know, combinations. That would be another choice, right?
Yeah, I agree with the opinion.
Actually,
and when it comes to lesion characteristics, this patient lesion has a very long calcified lesion, right?
Yes,
so,
right.
I'm concerned about the stand. The optimization issues and then the related to the future stent thrombosis event. So antiplatelet therapy is very, very important for this patient. So I first question, what is the strategy of antiplatelet for this patient? And second is PSP is enough to lesion modification for this lesion, very long and calcified lesion.
Yes, the first question, the how long we have to prescribe the depth or not. So currently, we don't have any correct answer to your very nice question. So we need a further randomized trial, like a DS-LATE, something like this. So State Park and our center plan to make a new clinical trial, VRS-LATE, VVS-LATE, to decide how long we have to apply the prescribed depth for this specific this kind of patient. We need some time to get the right answer. So in addition, the second question, pre-lesion modification, I applied a 3-0 high pressure, some dissection. I think it is enough to deliver the BRS in addition to the deliver in addition to the expansion of a BRS for this patient. Please give me a 3-0 BRS 28.
Mm-hmm. Actually, the angiographic appearance of this region is quite complex and difficult cases for BRS. But the balloon dilation with non-compliance balloon, the dissection is a good sign for the deliver for the BRS.
Yes.
Okay, this is a really educational case. Show us your PRS implantation technique step by step.
Okay, thank you. So
okay, right. You look at we prepare actually real practice cases, right? Today is we're going to show you know Andrew's life, right? Anyway, then if you, as you've seen, almost all cases is long lesion, look at this. In the remaining issues, remaining lesion subset for the coronary intervention, and main disease, you can do. I can do, right? Even guideline, more than 66% of cases, you know, PCI can do that, right? Everybody can do that. What about the bifurcation lesion subset, LAD, diagonal, circumflex, obtuse marginal, it doesn't mean anything. It's not a big deal, right? The reason why, up to this point, many technical issues, et cetera, et cetera. However, what do you think? Side branch is a small one, right? It's not a big deal. Remaining things in intervention cardiology, I personally think a long lesion subset with PRS. It's not a drug-eluting stent, right? And the meaning is, it's especially for the particular this patient, the young ages, you know, we need a second treatment, a bypass surgery, or et cetera, et cetera. So why not? One of the main purpose of PRS is the long lesion subset. Clear is our, you know, way of thinking. So still, we concerned about something, the sense thrombosis, et cetera, et cetera. However, if you look at the inside, it's not a related device itself. Mainly, lots of things related with the, you know, how to do physician's side. So we're going to see that. We need more data. And so we have some randomized study about the long lesion subset. So what I want to talk is long lesion subset is next one of our big, strong, you know, issues in the, for the intervention cardiology.
That is my comment. So I think that the long lesion with the BVS, so lesion preparation, very, very important. So PSP is really, really enough to two lesion preparation for like this lesion, severely calcified lesion. Some other strategy is needed for this lesion. I think that such as the rotator blader lesion modification is the mandatory for this lesion. The kinds of data we need.
What did you do that, Dr. An?
Yes, this is a 3.5 BRS or other BRS. Yes, hybrid is a very important ideas. I try to hybrid strategy to the left side. So this is a 3.528 BRS or other BRS.
You mean a two BRS, 3.5
yes.
BRS, proximal, distal,
yeah.
Mid portion, 3.5.
Yes.
Okay.
Depletion.
You have to consider the avoid the protruding the scaffold in the ostium of the right coronary artery.
Yes.
However, the overlapping is a little bit longer.
Yes, I don't.
We always think about the thickness of the scaffold, the PRS, angiographic appearances looks okay. However, when we look at the intracoronary imaging, is most of the physician was a little bit disappointed because the scaffold thickness is quite thicker.
Yes, I know. Dr. Hong, you are the expert than me. The previously, the first generation DES era, there is some report about the concern about the overlapping stent area. Some report show that the overlapping stent area increased the risk of some restenosis or something. But I believe the major important thing is the lumen area. Even though there is some overlapping, we achieved enough large lumen area. I think that overlapping may not have a clinical significance. So I know that because of limited length of BRS, so my overlapping is a little bit longer than my expectation. So I applied a very strong, very high pressure. So I like to achieve the very big enough scaffold area, particularly the overlapping area. So now I will apply the 3-0 high pressure balloon.
While you are applying the high pressure balloon at the BRS area, so I think BBS has a lot of issue to talk about, but I think these two patients is very young, so we have to get more better long-term outcome. So I had a lecture previously, and then If the lesion subset is a complex and multivessel disease and very young,
14,
so
16,
what, why didn't you adopt FFR-guided PCI rather than just putting a long DBS stent implantation?
Depletion? Yes, I already measured FFR. This patient, the three-vessel FFR is lower than 0.80. Definitely true triple-vessel disease. In addition, yes, we need further data, but I don't like to wait to get the perfect data. And then I believe even this moment, if I do good, patient outcome will be good. So I believe that why I choose the BRS instead of the DES. Apply the 28.
I think BRS only strategy is okay, and also DES only strategy is okay. But you adopt hybrid technique, hybrid strategy for BRS and DES. What is the advantage over the DES only or BRS only strategy? If you have an indication for putting a DES in minimum one region, I think DES strategy is more than better than hybrid technology. So, what do you think about it?
In particular, there is some technical limitation of a current version of BRS. So, expansion is limited and size is limited. And so, there is some clinical limitation. Size limitation, we cannot put the BRS in the left main because the biggest BRS is only 3.5. So sometimes the left main is 4.0, 4.5. In addition, clinical limitation is we cannot apply the BRS to the small vessel based on the observable clinical trial. So this kind of clinical lesion entity, I don't like put the current version of BRS. Instead, I like to put the current best DES, or for the small vessel, drug-coated balloon would be worse.
So clear, it's clear, DES versus BRS?
14.
If the clinical safety and efficacy concern exactly same, all right, we need more data, right? The reason why is we want to do some randomized study, et cetera, et cetera. Totally different thing is, BRS disappeared. The concept is totally different thing is concept, right? DS metal is long metal, is remain in the body, remain in the vessel, right? However, if it's exactly the same concern, equipose, BRS is disappeared. That is, we have to move to the, next phase in terms of intervention. So, still premature. So, however, personally, I think we need data, right?
Yes. In this patient, if we use a lot of the BRS in one patient, do you have another? Do you have a different antiplatelet strategy compared to the DES patient or just one or two BRS patient?
Still, we need the data, and so we just started with a random study with a 1 year, exactly the same with the drug-eluting stent, the aspirin Plavix, and then we just considered, PBS observed during the more than 2 years. We don't have data. However, we randomized after 1 year's depth and aspirin Plavix and aspirin alone, right? Exactly the same, manner with our previous study. And so we just started, and we need, more data. However, in multiple stem, even in the practical point of view, personally, I prefer three combinations, aspirin Plavix and cilostazol. Maybe you don't believe too much about the cilostazol, right? However, personally, as we have a lot of data, and so short-term, at least 6 months of cilostazol combined with the DAP, is perfect. So, practical point of view, we combine that. Okay.
I'd like to evaluate the IVUS surveillance. Here is this landing zone. I think it's very good.
Yes, Doctor. There is no complications or no residual plaque burden at the reference segment. It's optimal landing. And you can see the double layer of struts, so it's scaffolds. And the scaffolds area is more than 5.5, I think. And it is the calcified lesions, but the symmetry is relatively good. And the strut areas are also good. And there is no significant plaque protrusion or other suboptimal findings. And also, we see the fully expanded scaffolds here. And also, this is a little eccentric shape because of the presence of outside calcium, but the area is still good. And I think area is more than 6 square millimeter here. And also, you see the fully opposed struts. And there is no significant malposition or other complicated findings. There also, this is the proximal part of RCA, and there is big scaffolds, some protrusion here, but it's not so significant and very minor plaque protrusion. And also, here is a big RCA, and the expansion and opposition is so good on the IVUS images.
Let's just see the ostium.
Yes, it covers the ostium of RCA, and there is this is a minor malposition, but it's not so significant, and some of the struts are malposed, but the distance is very small.
You may know that my first proximal scaffold did not protrude to the ostium. So I think the proximal landing, I'm very satisfied. So could you measure the minimal scaffold area and the could you measure the area of overlapping area?
Okay.
That is the important point.
Yes, I think it's the overlapping side, and also it is the previously the minimal luminary side. And you can see the outside calcium here, but the scaffold area is 6.1 square millimeter. It's quite enough.
Based on the DS data.
Yes, but but we know that the data show that acute gain is less in the BBS versus the DES, but the BBS will have late luminal enlargement. So the considering overall, we expect a good result.
This is the smallest area?
Yes.
And
yes,
could you measure the overlapping part?
It's also the overlapping portion.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so doctor, we're going to move another cath lab.
Okay.
Preparing and then we will be back, right?
Okay.
Dr. Lee.
Good morning. So welcome to CAS Labs. So this is a very simple case. Let me pre-introduce his history. My fellow changed, so she don't know history. This is a 69 years old man presenting with effort chasing for 8 months. He has been treated with optimal medical therapy, but he still complains of chest pain despite maximal medical therapy. So-called this patient has medically refractory angina. So we take a coronary angiogram. We took coronary angiogram last week, and here is angiogram. Spider view, as you can see, LAD ostium is moderately narrowed, and distal, main, and proximal circle mild disease. Next view, and this is worst view, and best view, area caudal view. May I get opinion from the panel? Dr. Hong, would you do FFR in this situation?
No.
No? Just to do stent implantation? 1 minute procedure.
I cannot follow the story. I do some message from the hospital.
This patient has medically...
If you have any objective the evidence of the ischemia in this patient?
No.
Treadmill or
others? No. No treadmill, no thallium.
Did you do the FFR?
Do you need this FFR for this patient?
Yes, I want to do that. Right?
Okay, so it's 1 week ago, actually, we measured FFR.
It just depends on you, right?
Yeah, we measured 1 week ago, not right now. FFR value was 0.8. So is it reasonable threshold to do PCI?
FFR 0.8?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. I want to do that. Yeah. We got recent, you know, very controversial data in the gray zone between the 0.7 and 0.8, and also the critical stenosis proximal LED is a large, you know, Jeopardy myocardium included. We have a little bit more, you know, premature data. So treat or not treat concerns, I prefer treat. The okay. reason why, you know, the big myocardiums, if, you know, some event can make is a hard endpoint, is a mortality, is a, you know, big myocardial infarction.
Okay, I agree with you, Susa. I usually measure FFR if the lesion is questionable, such as intermediate lesion or multiple lesion, to search for the carpal site. So some views is only mildly narrowed, so I measured FFR and 0.8. As everybody knows, so, the risk of MACE is steeply increased when FFR less than 0.8. So we have rationale, medical refractory symptom, and this is ischemia producing lesion. And the lesion morphology is very favorable for PCI. So there are no reason to hesitate to the PCI for in this situation. So we put wire plus usual wire, LED high top floppy wire, and circumflex choice PT wire. And we measure the IVUS for LED. Can you show us the IVUS, Dr. Hong?
Sorry for interrupting. Did you already measure the FFR in this patient?
1 week ago.
1 minute ago.
1 week.
Seven days ago.
Yeah,
sorry.
7 days ago, yes. Okay. 1 minute ago, I measured the IVUS examination. I did the IVUS examination.
So. Okay, I'll show you the IVUS image. This is proximal LED, distal reference segment. The lumen diameter is 3.8. You can see some eccentric plaque. Here is the LED osteal lesion. The MLA is 3.1. The disease is extended to the left main body. The distance between left main bifurcation to the left main lesion is 4.2. And total lesion length is 9.1.
Minimal lumen area is 4.2?
3.1.
3.1. This is very big LED. So let me show you AP caudal. So-called wrap around LEDs. So LED supplies anterolateral, apex, and apical inferior. So this is a huge LED. So I think ischemic territory is more than 40% of left ventricle. So definite indication for PCI.
So yes, Dr. Lee?
Yes.
Dr. Che?
Yes.
Yeah. Once upon a time, you loved directional atherectomy very much.
Yeah. This is not available here.
Yeah, yeah. In this patient, do you think it is necessary to use directional atherectomy?
I don't think so, because it's LED osteal lesion is a very high risk area of restenosis. You put bare metal stent or directional atherectomy, the risk of restenosis is very high. It's more than 30%, usually involving left main bifurcation. So now in the DS era, we can treat this LED osteum. So DCA alone this may not work.
Yes, sure. But in Korea, all over the world, we don't, DCA is not available. Oh. But only country, the Japan.
Japan, yeah, yeah. I know. Yeah.
So what do you think about the DCA? Is it necessary? Yes.
Yes. Yes. I think that this is one of the candidates. So my brother is very loved the DCA for this period. But I think that proximal LED is a good and candidate for it and overlaps stenting. Just and we can fix it. But in the osteum on the LCX, we be and treated with a DCA and put the stent to left main already. Isn't I think one of the candidate over DCA. So, but I think 30% risk rate, my brother won't admit about that because an aggressive DCA and decrease more than the risk rate. But anyway, in Korea, it's not available. So and we go further, the indication of the
I think, I think DCL is useful to prevent circumference compromise because of plaque shift. In these patients, the plaque actually not exactly located on the opposite side of carina. Plaque actually involved carina. Can you explain this, Dr. Huang? Great. This is a usual pattern or unusual patterns? Plaque distribution.
Usually the branching point is maybe in this case this is free. We can see some eccentric plaque involving some
carina also involved.
So Dr. Lee, what would you do that?
So I put protection wire because the carina angle is narrow and carina or plaque also involved carina. Mm-hmm. So I'm worried about the side branch losses after main branch stent.
Okay, you want to do the stent crossover, right?
Oh, of course. So the only way.
So what about DSO or BBS?
DS.
DS, all right, great.
Because
post
DS
cases.
Yeah.
Anyway, so the angle, lamps branches, the angle is too shallow, so yes, you want to protect the guide wire. The reason why is it's some, you know, carina shift something, right?
So this is just a quick procedure.
You know, the IVUS evaluation, as well as the quantitative evaluation, the qualitative evaluation, there is some occlusant and some flow disturbance, flow in the within a plaque. It means some vulnerable characteristics. So if you do the dilate and then aggressively, it might be some elevation of the cardiac enzyme or some slow flow after the stent deployment.
So actually, I did this pre-dilation with 2.5 15 millimeter because of several reasons. First, to check the dilatability of the carpal lesion before stenting. Some lesion is very difficult to dilate after stent implantation. So the lesion should be checked by IVUS examination or pre-dilation. And second is to prevent slipping of the stent during stenting delivery. Pre-arm modification with pre-dilation is helpful to prevent stent migration during stenting procedure. And finally, to measure the lesion length. Probably the lesion length measured by non-inflated balloon may be the most accurate. So I did this is a pre-dilation using underdilate balloon.
Doctor, you did IVUS, right?
Yes.
So
yes.
What do you think is really particular for osteo lesion? Something that we need some, you know, more detailed information. So, however, IVUS guided concern, QCA guided concern, you got some idea, right?
I think so. QCA is very accurate. We measured QCA in this patients distal lumen diameter 3.7 by QCA. And proximal diameter 4.1, so a little bit smaller than the IVUS measured diameters. So this is a high pressure non-compliant balloon 4.0, go nominal.
12.
What pressure?
12 nominal. 16.
12.
16.
16.
Deflect.
Did you cover the osteal part of the main?
No. This is
just
middle portion of left main. And 20. I usually did this post dilation very aggressively to remove this residual stenosis. Deplete. Okay. QCA, I think it's a QCA guided PCI is very useful. QCA always underestimate underestimate the true lumen diameter because of luminogram property. And I was always overestimate because of ultrasound property. So, so roughly 10%, if you add 10% of this reference diameter, is approaches real value. So let me check. Ivers, yes.
Okay.
Nitro, please.
Would you take a picture first?
Okay.
we are very anxious about it, right?
Okay, nitro. Hondamun, 괜찮죠? 물어봐. Test. And you?
Good.
Let me go.
Main vessel is perfect. Lamps intermediates. If you know there are some narrowing, but the flow is good. Yeah, TMA3
yes.
flow. So.
Okay, Ivers.
This is proximal lady distal reference segment. You can see some disease, some calcified nodule.
Main
yeah,
approaching
to the distal part. No edge
okay.
dissection at the distal reference segment.
Stent
is
no
well expanded and well opposed so far. The stent diameter is 1, 2, 3, 4, about 4. Circumflex.
We did post dilation up to 4, 4 in 3 using non compliant 10 millimeter balloon.
Perfect. No stent expansion.
Yes.
So minimal stent diameter is almost 4. Yeah.
Okay.
Stent area is 12 something.
I would like to finish
Wait.
The procedure. So nitro.
All right, it's clear. Make it simple.
Yes.
Right. Lots of discussions. You know, and you can make it simple. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Move, Dr. An's care lab.
Okay.
And then we want to see the, what's happened. Dr. An, Jung-Min An.
Yes,
okay.
I'm Dr. An. The left side, same patient again. Initially, I told you that I like to multiple BLS implantation. But after taking the left side coronary angiogram and IVUS, I changed my mind. So I insert the circumflex wire and LED wire. Circumflex, processor complex very tight. Could you show us RAO cranial view? Yes, middle to proximal LED is very tight. And I was finding it very interesting. Dr. Gang, could you show us I was finding?
Okay.
This is LED pullback, LED to left main pullback.
Yes, here is the distal part of the lesions, and you can see that there is a normal-looking segment. Then disease appears, and you see the attenuated plaque with a large plaque burden. The vessel size is 2.9 millimeter at the distal reference, and then you can see the encircling plaque, but it's minimal here, and some small calcification is appeared, and we can move to the proximally and. You see that after the branching site, there is some calcified eccentric plaque here, and it's very diffuse lung disease, and some constrictive remodeling site is noticed, and then here is the big vessel. The vessel size is more than 3.5 millimeter with some maintained lumen, but with some disease. And here is calcified nodule at the LAD osteo
yes, here is LAD osteo.
Yes, here is
yes.
LAD osteo, and big vessel and circumflex is coming from 2 o'clock. And also you can see the calcified nodule heel and the guide wire mm-hmm. is coming in as well. And this is left main. It is a very big vessel, more than 5 millimeter, and a huge attenuated plaque. and the lumen area was measured previously, then the minimal lumen area was here, the 6.1 square millimeter, and it's very eccentric. That makes the discrepancy in the lumen lumen diameter in the different angiographic views. And then the plaque is extended to the very osteal part of left main, and you can see the aorta.
Up to osteal part, right? The small plaque. So what would you do that, right?
So the main problem is there is LAD osteal disease. So this is my the region I changed my mind. So there is another culprit region, the circumplex. Could you show us an angiogram? So I like to put the BRS. You mentioned the hybrid approach for the proximal to the mid LAD. I put the BRS around 3023 something, and then I like to do the left main stenting. Because
main stenting with the drug-eluting stent, right?
Yes, right. I believe that the left main itself, physiologic significance, I believe not significant, but the disease is continuously from the left main to the LAD osteo. We cannot separate the treated this region. So we have to put the stent from the left main to the mid LAD. Do you agree with my opinion?
Okay. Please make it simple. It's quite complex, you know.
From
the right coronary arteries, the left main disease, and it kind of a multivessel left main disease, and so we are gonna have a lot of consideration. So, Dr. Han.
Yes.
Okay, just Dr. Hong, I'm gonna have a basic lecture first, right?
Of course.
We'll be back right soon.
Okay. I will show you my procedure result later.
All right. I want presentations at the basics. Why we have to consider PCI? It's patient and region selection. It kind of basics. However, we need more data. Why PCI? It's transradial. Just only to avoid the surgery, big incisions, you know, we don't like that. Survival benefit of bypass surgery or medication in stable disease in 2016 consensus, including recent data, STEECH trial, main disease, three vessel with LV dysfunction, including ischemic cardiomyopathy, right? Even ejection fraction less than 30-35%, still surgery is better. That is recent, updated guideline. However, if you look at the PCI, no survival benefit or medications. Any meta-analysis is clearly show that all hard endpoint, no difference. Only difference is angina symptom relief. And so why no survival benefit of angioplasty? As again, if you look at the graph, revascularization is better in case of a large ischemic burden, at least more than 10%, large ischemic burden. Typical example is the main and multivessel disease. However, in our real practice concern, PCI is still was performed in a relatively small ischemic burden. So I always, classify very subjective, cosmetic angioplasty, non-viable, asymptomatic, small ischemic myocardium, negative FFR. In any case, actually, that is cosmetic angioplasty defined with the publication, the inappropriate angioplasty, almost more than 50% in our real practice. For angina relief, I would say kind of a symptomatic angioplasty. For large ischemic burdens, main disease, three vessel disease, inevitably, that would be the good candidate for angioplasty in current practice, in your future concern. So patient selection, YPCI, symptom relief, and survival benefit of medications, main PCI and multivessel PCI. No doubt about this. It's a complex PCI in the future. And the recent practice, treated vessel territory. This is our data. So after routine use of FFR, and we got the more functional concept. Look at this. Mainly, we treated the main disease and prox LAD disease and RCA and circumflex is less than 50%. You know, main target would be the main NLAD. So I would just briefly review the current status of main PCI, not many data. However, this is our main compare 5 years data. Hard endpoint deaths, composite deaths, MI strong, no difference. Only difference is TBR. Although you look at main subset, the syntax study 5 years data, absolutely no difference between the even PCI group with use of taxes, not a significant difference is surgery versus, this is our pre-combat randomized study, PCI with a SIFO, death MI stroke TBR, actually not statistical difference between the two. And we gather the whole patient level meta-analysis. There's a syntax, pre-combat, and best patient level meta-analysis. Main subset, death MI stroke, absolutely same, no difference at all. Main subset, and if you look at the separate with the disease entity, main alone, main with a single vessel, more simple procedure, better outcomes in a PCI, even better PCI. And main and three vessel, two vessel disease, quite equivalent, you know, not inferior in terms of a surgery. And so DS versus surgery, main disease, outcome of a PCI with the regurgitating stent comparable with the bypass surgery, even better survival in selected patient group. CABG is still better with some, you know, comorbidity status, history of heart failure, chronic kidney disease. That is our data. Recent presented, published Excel study, clearly same, death and MI, strokes, real follow-up data, not too much difference. Novel study, a little bit different. The surgery is still better. There are lots of, you know, issues that we have to discuss. And the current guideline, the reason why we have almost more than 60% of a patient had a, you know, good candidate for PCI, 1B2A class, and so main disease is not surgical disease anymore. What about the current status of multivessel disease? Very 2D study, PCI, out of the summary, PCI, low-risk diabetic patient and medical treatment, actually no difference. High-risk patient, bypass surgery is clearly better in patient who had a diabetic patient. Freedom study, diabetes, multivessel disease, and CABG is better. Look at this. The PCI arm, they used CIFO and Texas, not used, you know. And syntax three-vessel subset is clearly better outcomes in surgery and multivessel disease. The best study is our one. We use the giants with the PCI compared to bypass surgery, still better outcomes in surgery, right? And my meta-analysis, patient level data, the multivessel subset, clearly better outcome in surgery rather than the PCI. Last year, just almost same message from the New York large registries, propensity match with the PCI, giants and bypass surgery, absolutely no difference in heart endpoint. However, still myocardial infarction is higher in a group of the PCI, stroke is higher surgery, repeat revascularization is higher in group of the PCI. As a consensus 2016, CABG is better for the multivessel disease and diabetics and predominant three-vessel disease. So from the data, even we use the second generation drug-eluting stent, CABG is still better for multivessel disease, even after new drug-eluting stent use. What about the impact of complete revascularization? It's not a, you know, a game over. Look at this. If you look at the subgroup analysis from the New York registry data, complete revascularization, absolutely same, not too much difference in death and MI stroke. Still, repeat revascularization high in PCI. However, incomplete revascularization, and look at this, myocardial infarction is statistically higher in a group of the PCI. We separate with exactly the same manners from best our study. Complete revascularization, absolutely same. In case of incomplete revascularization and frequency of myocardial infarction is high, composite endpoint is high, MACE rate high, we clarify the impact of complete revascularization. Our registry data is clear. Incomplete revascularization is higher frequency of myocardial infarction, and almost same trend, meta-analysis from the patient level data, complete versus incomplete. Incomplete is higher, you know, cumulative MACE rate, compared with incomplete revascularization, complete revascularization, almost same with the surgery, right? So what we've learned from the current data, complete revascularization is another important practical issue in case of a multivessel PCI. Look at this. Current guideline, elective PCI for three vessel disease, don't touch. You know, any, you know, tarsal, intermediate tarsal, high tarsal, is a 3B, right, indication for PCI. I don't believe this one. Look at this. Syntax score, Patrick published their data, poor discrimination power. The syntax score and tarsal based on the syntax score showed poor discrimination among the low intermediate high syntax score group. However, combining clinical factors and syntax score retained a predictive performance. The meaning is they moved to the syntax score 2, including the many clinical variable, that's clear, right? It's not related with the angiographic stratification. So I would say kind of a practical guideline in our practice. How would you define the PCI? Reason is favorable anatomy for PCI, complete revascularization should be considered, right? And if reason is unfavorable anatomy for PCI, send the patient to the surgery, right? That is very simple, make it simple, right? It's clear. And what about the region selection? What is a favorable region for angioplasty? That is, you know, ultimate question. So what is the favorable one? So I would say functionally significant any coronary stenosis, QC reference vessel diameter more than 2.5 millimeters, we should consider relatively big vessel. Region length less than 50 millimeters, the restenosis rate and here are less than 2%. We got a data, this is not a, and if in any lesion, after stent, the stent minimal diameter 2.5, more than 2.5 millimeter, and I've stent more than 5.5 millimeter square, the TRL rate less than 2%. In any data, it clearly demonstrate this one. So I would say the YPCIs, two things, so symptom relief, and survival benefit for the multivessel and the main disease. And what is favorable for PCL? Look at this. Today, we're going to see a little bit tough one. However, QCA angio guided less than 50 millimeters, around the 60 millimeter lesion length would be okay. If you got some IVE's concept, you know, after stent, minimal stent areas, minimal lumen diameter. So thank you for your attention.
Any question, comment about the Dr. Bach's presentation?
Santos.
Next question.
Live.
Okay.
Is this from the floor?
Enjoy your lecture as usual. I want to have your opinion regarding. Complete. As I said, the completeness of revascularization is very important. But I want to have your opinion regarding completeness as assessed by angiography versus completeness as assessed by functional evaluation. Because we know from the data from FAME, for example, the FAME series studies, that it is probably more important to have completeness as assessed by FFR.
Complete revascularization?
Yes, completeness of revascularization. What you mentioned in your slides, completeness as assessed by angiography.
Understand,
right?
So I believe functionally cerebral disease, right? Functionally cerebral disease must be, you know, complete revascularization. We still, very limited data, right? So current status, we have some combined many data, functionally significant true three vessel disease treated with a complete revascularization. That is it.
Yeah, I agree with your opinion. However, your data from the anatomically oriented data, not the functionally treated data, syntax or the others.
Right, so I just, I really, I can say it's just the beginning, right? is the current status, the DS, is, you know, surgery is better than the PCI. Oh, no, no, I don't believe that one. So just the beginning, we don't have any data so from the functional concept things. Right?
Yeah. Hi, Dr. Raju. One comment to add. This high-risk subset group, the next level is impeller hemodynamic support, which will allow us to do complete revascularization in a much safer way. Hemodynamic support has also evolved, as you know. I'm sure it's not available here yet. Impeller hemodynamic support for complete revascularization in multivessel and left main disease has really made it simple for these patients.
Agree.
In case of that, to use the impeller, is some small group,
correct,
not the overall patient. Okay, good question. Okay. Let's go to the live
line.
Case.
Okay.
Go ahead. Please show us. Okay.
Still, you are doing some cases, right?
Yes.
What are you doing?
Long. Population.
Long cases.
Doctor Han, please show us the progress.
Would you explain that what you've done?
Yes. Just a moment, please. Yes, initially, yes, okay. Initially, I like to make a simple, but the patient lesion was not simple. So I'm not so that much smart. But anyway, previously, could you show us the PRS? I applied a 3-0 high pressure balloon for lesion modification, and next, I think this is good for BRS delivery and expansion. And then I put the 3-0 BRS 28, and then next, I applied a 3-0 high pressure serially. Applied, and then left main, for the left main next. So 4-0 stent. Before left main stenting, I already put the circumplex stent and balloon cloche. So next. Yes, I'd like to show you the current status.
So you deployed another stent for the circumflex ocean.
Yes, right.
And then balloon crushing.
Yes, right.
All right, good. And then?
Ostium ulcer, not the distal part.
Yes, not distal, the proximal ostium, proximal sulcus. There is a tightest lesion. Distal, I think very small vessel, so I don't like to put the stent for that small vessel.
So what kind of DS?
Giant stent.
Giant.
Yeah. Actually,
so
there
you
is.
You did the mini crush?
A balloon crush first.
Yeah,
yes,
yeah. Mini crush.
Yeah, okay.
So I'd like to show you some hybrid approaches I was finding. Definitely, I need some high pressure balloon for the transition zone from BRS to DES. Okay, here is the distal landing.
Okay.
Quite a normal vessel, I landed.
Okay, distal landing of a BBS first, right?
Yes, right.
Okay, great.
Dr. Gan?
So
this is normal looking.
Obviously, it's more bigger shot. Okay, great.
Okay. This is a 3-0 vessel, no 3-0. Disease.
Distal?
Yes. Okay, BRS is coming. Distal
landing. Good.
I'm thinking it's good, very expanded.
Mm.
Scaffold area is quite good, well opposed. Actually, there is some limitation to evaluate the opposition to the wall, but I think it's good. There is some first tight lesion. I need a further high pressure ballooning to achieve the larger scaffold area. The scaffold length is 28.
Okay. diameter concerns at least 2.25, right?
Yes.
2.5 means same cross-sectional area, polymer area is 5 something?
Yeah, 5.
At least more than that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Here
we need a new cutoff value in terms of which one is good, right?
Here must be the overlapping area. I put the 4-0 giant stain.
Mm-hmm. You throw it to stain?
Yeah, throw it to stain. Yeah.
All right. Good transition.
Yes.
Big stain diameters, almost more than four, right?
Yeah, right.
I think the practice pattern of the LED to the left main is for the PRS implantation is quite reasonable. Sometimes we initially plan to the PRS alone, and then during the IBS finding, we have the very big size of the vessel. So therefore, we change the whole thing. We try to the drug irritant stent the whole thing. However, in these cases, the available for the available vessel size PRS and the bigger size of the drug irritant stent, I think is a good combination of the procedure in such kind of the some vessel difference.
The position wise, the proximal end of the drug irritant stent just precise 0.5 millimeter is hanging out.
Yeah,
how would you do that?
By chance.
By chance. All right.
Now you are trying to cross the wire in the RCM officer.
No, I like to optimizing the scaffold first using 3.5.
Scaffold size is 3.5.
No, 3.0. This is just a 3.0 vessel. Mm-hmm. So
why do you inflate the scaffold with a 3.5?
Because
even though the IBS finding is quite reasonable and acceptable.
No,
why did you that?
I believe bigger better.
If you believe the bigger one,
yeah.
You try to initially deploy the bigger BBS. 3.5 rather than the 3.0.
Yes, that is a very good suggestion, but I don't make some edge dissection something. Yes, even there is a quite normal distal landing zone, but sometimes it happens. So to avoid the distal dissection something, as you know, scaffold thickness is thick and not a smooth, so scaffold sometimes make distal dissection so frequently. So to avoid this kind of complication, I choose 3.0. In addition, we can apply the 3.5 balloon for 3.0 BRS scaffold. In addition, this has some high pressure balloon after BRS implantation may have some advantage to decrease the polymer density something. So personally, I like to choose the 3.0 rather than 3.5. Here is the transition zone.
I have another comment about the size of a BRS and a DES. Yes, if you put a 4.0 DES overlap inside the 3.0 BRS, there is a high risk for BRS fracture right after the distal edge of the stent.
Yeah.
So what do you think about it? Yes. So 4.0 inside the 3.0 BRS, 16. Is there any increased risk of fracture?
Yes, I agree with your opinion. So I applied the low pressure initially and a little bit pulled back the stem balloon and then applied the nominal pressure. So I have the same concern about the damage to the proximal scaffold. So I take care of the implanted pressure to the proximal DES.
Yes, good technique. I saw there is no scaffold fracture during the IVUS evaluation. Thank you.
So I apply the high pressure using 3.5, and then I like to move to the circumflex rewiring.
So you want to do the final kissing balloon?
Yes.
Inflation for the remain, right?
Yes, right. Definitely.
Okay, we want to be back in the after the, you know, Dogu Bak cases. Okay. Dr. Bak, can you hear me?
Okay, the room number one. Okay, can you hear me?
Right. What have you done?
Yes, we have a lot of the obstacle. We have a lot of spend a lot of time.
Still, then, yes. Still survive.
Okay,
right?
We removed the guiding caster and finished the procedure. Quickly show up. This is the epicranial view. You can see the very tortoise angle and the next. And we treat the balloon. This is the compliant balloon. It's 2.5, and then there was some severe, you know, compromise of the OM branch. At this point, we dilated using the 2.5, and then after 2.5 compliant balloon, the OM branch is okay. IBUS measures, the length was 38. We put the 3.0 giants, 38 stand, and then we shows there is some the compromised OM branch, and we try to we do the high pressure balloon dilation. This is 3.5, and then there was some compromised region, and the next, and then show that we did some the wire cross recross the OM branch, and this is a 2.0 balloon, and here is abruptly wire is incidentally pulled out the OM branch. So next, so we tried to several times to recross the OM branch next, but we spent more 10 minutes. We finally failed. Decided to leave it along the OM branch region. And then next, the problem is the LAD region is that look at the LAD region, it's a very tortuous region, some calcified region. It's like some hardness. It's a very tortuous angle. At first, I tried to the Seon wire. The wire does not fast, and then I adapt the microcaster with the Seon wire. I tried to the Seon wire, but unfortunately, the wire was past the first lumen. So I rechanged the field FC wire. The wire doesn't work, and I rechanged the choice PT wire. Was definitely failed. There is some severe dissection of the LAD region. I was very angry. Our team was definitely perplexed. The flow was some compromised. And the next I spent more than 30 minutes rewiring. Finally, I decided to conventional wire. The pseudo knuckle wire technique is used intermediate BMW wire. Very, very fortunately, wire was the past the distal LAD region, and then I put the microcaster and rechange the long the BMW wire. We did a pre-dilation balloon 2.5, but this is the post-dilation images. There was very diffuse region. We quickly checked IBUS. The distal part vessel size is 2.7. The mid part 3.0. Proximal part is 30.5. The lesion length is very long. So we decided to directly put the long stand. Distal part, we put the 3.75 giants 38. And then the proximal part, we put the additional long stand 38 millimeter 3.5 giants stand. And the next, this is the implanted another very long wire. Result is good. Finally, we did the 3.0, 3.5 non-compliant balloon high press dilation. This is the high press dilation. This is the final image. Is the wire was totally removed. The circle region is okay. LAD region is okay. We checked finally IBUS. Could you show us IBUS?
May I ask the total length of the stand?
So how many stand?
White was BVS 2, left is BVS.
You have a time, calculate
it. 3 times. It's more than
Do you know the main theme of the symposium?
Yeah, the complex PCI.
Makes it simple.
Makes simple, yeah.
But you make some more complicated.
Yeah, right. So, but I just try to.
As LAD concern is, you know, we are not expecting this one, right?
Yeah, right.
So
right.
It just happens.
Yeah, and right.
Some kind of, you know, rescue procedures.
Yeah.
Anyways, we're going to make a, you made a, you know, polymer jacket and yeah, metal right. jacket yeah, for, right. you have to pay.
Yeah. So. Okay, the IBUS was quickly yeah. The explain the final IBUS.
Yeah, this is this part. There is no dissection. Stain is well expanded symmetrically, and minimal lumen, minimal stain area around 4.4, which is 2.7 stain area.
Great. And what stain do you use?
The Giants, what? 38.
This is you have to use the other, you know, yeah. various yeah, right, kind right. of DS.
Only,
right?
only
it's
one.
It's very political.
Yeah,
measure,
right. right.
And only 1 millimeter overlap in this stent. Yeah, in this stent, and this proximal part, fortunately, only 2 millimeter protrude to the left main. So it's quite a good result. Yeah. In this case, we have some lesson because we have to, yeah, check the angle of the coronary artery
yes.
Before the procedure, yeah, especially for the LAD
yeah,
lesion.
Right.
Hey, Dr. Hong, would you mention about any comment on that?
Okay. The when you meet these cases,
yes.
try to solve it simple.
Yes.
And particularly in the LAD cases, do not IBS post the IBS because you have too much exhausted to fix it, everything.
Yes, yes.
So it makes some trouble or
yes.
some complication
yeah,
during
right.
the procedure.
Yeah.
It's some natural. So procedure time should be shorter.
Yes, yes.
Shorter, faster, is a simple. It's a best for the patient.
Dr. Ba, why don't you show this
okay,
image?
OK, could you,
yeah,
could
yeah.
you show
yeah.
The,
yeah.
the previous image? Is a spider view. Can you see the
yeah.
spider view? OK. PEX image. Okay, can you see the PEX image? Okay, yes, look at this is the spider view. At first, I think just the vessel route would be straightforward. I recall my procedure. Look at the spider view. There was a very, very tortuous angle. Just I tried to keep the hydrophilic wire is caused some rescue procedure. And I think even though it's the epicoral view is simple, straightforward, is check the view, check the several the aspect of view of the synagram.
Okay, I want to just want to mention, but in terms of OM branches, side branches, I didn't catch up the immediate after stent crossover. If there was a TME 3 floor,
yes.
even I don't want to touch, right? You just inflate the 2-0 balloon for the side branches. There was some, I don't know, some dissection. So we have to expect that. And so still, the small myocardium, small branch, less than 2.5, 2.0 millimeters, and TME 3 floor is quite enough, right?
Yeah,
that is,
right,
you
right.
spend a lot of time. Anyways,
yes.
you can get a good angiography outcomes. And so I think it's okay. So just one mention. And recent our registry published data, look at this, is we deployed the 38, right? Long stands, yeah. So the cutoff value, you know, what is the worst outcomes in the, you know, consecutive metal jacket? And so based on our data, Dr. Hong, your data is less than 40 millimeter, it's perfect, right? However, QCA length is really longer, based on the additional data, it's a 15 millimeter something. And finally, we published our data, worst outcome related with more than 80 millimeters. Right, this data. So I just, sorry, in the practical concern, 38 long stand, okay. Just use, right? However, you can make a 2.5 minimal diameter, yeah? 5.5. You made it 5.5 stent cross-sectional area. So however, 60, it's okay. However, more than 80 something, right? We should consider BRS first, right? BRS first. That is my practical concern. So Dr. Hong, what do you want to talk something?
Actually, I have no comment about idea about it. Anyhow, I agree with the opinion. And in this case, in the circle, the Togubak deployed the long stent length, but in the patient side, I think it's just fixed the proximal suck. Mm-hmm. That's it. And the other, the distal circ and the obtuse marginal branch, there is some disease. But as we know, according to the FAME study and the college trial, we have another strong weapon. Mm-hmm. The medical treatment is quite enough.
Okay.
Fix the small territory of from the proximal circ to the distal one. I think we have to think
okay,
about
Dr.
that.
Okay, Dr. Bach. Okay, nice case presentation.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
See you later. We're going to move Dr. An's care lab. Okay, Jung-Min An. What is your final result?
Okay. Yes, I'd like to share still. I left only one thing. Okay, inflation.
You want to see final result first before
this is
lecture
my
start?
Okay. Inflation.
Okay. Final. Still doing kissing balloon inflation.
Yes. And then 8.8.
All right. More?
Yes. Left manage a very big. More than 4.5 depletion.
So we're going to see the angiogram quickly.
Yes. Okay. All right. I'd like to show you just a moment. Okay. Test.
Picture?
Okay.
Good. Big enough.
Ready?
No restenosis. I guarantee. So, whatever you choose the two-cent technique in terms of bifurcation, excuse me, so we have a recent, scenarios of 5, 6, 7, 8 millimeters squared from the circumflex, LAD, and POC, and the main, right? I think it's quite perfect. Good.
Thank you.
All right. Nice presentation. So, okay, we want to move next lecture from Cheol-Han Lee. Actually, it's a long title. PCI versus CABG, multivessel disease, ischemic heart failure, QC versus imaging guidance, and metal versus polymer jacket, BBS long, and hold the future trial concern. Dr. Lee will give us talk.
Okay, thank you very much for your kind introductions. Let me briefly talk about the three topics, ischemic heart failure, PCI guidance, and long lesions. Let me start with ischemic heart failure, CABG versus PCI. Here is guideline for revascularization in CVRF dysfunction, left ventricular ejection fraction less than 35. ACC AHA guidelines basically recommend medication first, and CABG for non-left mains, 2B, and PCI not recommended because of insufficient data. However, ESC recommend CABG for left main class 1C and multivessel disease 1B. PCI is recommended if CABG not suitable. However, this guideline, this recommendation should be updated based on